Welcome everyone. And we also have some new participants today who've been invited to the session. So we'd like to welcome you to our school counselor engagement program. Thank you for joining us. I've been so looking forward to having our speakers speak to us today and sharing their wisdom in their workplace, in computer science and accessibility and addressing those topics. I'd also like to introduce to you, we have Ruth Kyle on the call, and she is a school counselor in Anna, Texas. So if you are near Ruth, drop your name in the chat, introduce yourself to Ruth, because I know we have many counselors from Texas.
Melissa, Texas.
Oh, where are you from?
I'm in Melissa. I live in Anna.
Okay. So female names. Tell me about that.
I'm not sure. It had to do with McKinney, who is the next town over, and Colin. His name is actually Colin McKinney, and the daughters and all that.
Oh, okay. Got it. Well, Ruth has been a school counselor, what, for 17, 18 years now?
Yes. Yeah? Yes.
And from pre-K all the way through high school, you have experience in adolescent residential treatment. You hold a bachelor's and master's degree in music education. And then you continue your master's in school counseling at East Central University in Oklahoma. And are you still working on your LPC? Are you currently?
I'm getting my hours. I've completed all the college portion. I'm just getting those elusive 3,000 hours that are hanging out there. So.
Wow, Ruth, I don't know how you do it. So you are obviously a consultant with us with Counselors for Computing, and you're a cheerleader for all things computer science and the different promoting different pathways and careers and degrees. And so we're glad you're on the call as well to help share your story and wisdom of things that you do in Texas with the school counselor. So thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
And so what I'd like to now do is introduce our speakers. And I'm first going to introduce Mina Das. And Mina, you are a graduate student, but I think you're finishing up pretty soon, right?
Yes, my last week at school now, so that's Ooh. Really exciting.
Oh, you're the celebration button, right? Oh, I'm so proud. Okay, so at Auburn University, so I like need to finish my sentences, right? You work on web development, machine learning, and accessibility and technology. I want to speak to more recently, well, you are going to share your story and the challenges of having a speech disorder and disability, and you are now an advocate for accessibility. And more recently, I have learned that you are an inductee with the National Disability Mentoring Coalition. So I imagine that you are now a mentor for others. Is that right?
Yes.
Wonderful. And you are a finalist for the Hearn Award. You are an NCWIT Collegiate finalist, the Ruderman Family Foundation Leadership Program, which focuses on leadership and advocacy, which is just amazing. I can't wait to hear more about all of that. And so you'll share pieces that I know I'm missing. But I think you're also signing on with Microsoft soon, right?
Yes, I'm excited.
Good. And then Ather is on the call as well. And you also serve in a variety of capacities as a leader and a mentor and increasing accessibility and information technology. You are in your third year, Ather, as a PhD student. Wonderful. And I'm just wanting to make sure I get everything. Recently, you received the 2021 Excellence in Entrepreneurial Leadership Award. I cannot wait to hear about that. And then you are the 2020 Do It Trailblazer, 2019 Teach Access Study Away Silicon Valley. There are so many programs that we all need to learn more about as we guide our students in computer science. So yeah, we can't wait to hear about all that. And Athers will make sure I'm speaking to where you are studying. You're studying at the Paul G. Allen School of Computer Science and Engineering at University of Washington. Do you refer to it as the Paul G. Allen School of Computer Science? Like that long name?
We just call it a CSE, but yeah.
Okay, wonderful. Wanted to get it right. Okay, well, I am now going to turn it over to both of you to share your story about your journey in computer science. So what would you like? What would be easier for you? Would you like to screen share, or would you like us to screen share for you?
So we can screen share. I think it would be a lot easier to do that. Or if that's fine with you, Aether.
Either is fine with me. I'm also just happy to say, please advance to the next slide. It's all good.
Okay. I'll share. Oh, okay. I'll share my screen then. Sorry. Okay. And you'll see my screen. Okay. I'm gonna start presenting. Okay. I don't know how this goes forward.
Let's see. Okay. That looks good.
Okay. So hi, everybody. My name is Mina. I'm a master's student studying computer science at Auburn, and I'm here to share my story with all of you. So I was born and raised in India, and somewhere at the age of 5 to 6, I was diagnosed with a speech impediment, specifically a stutter, as you can see. And my childhood was not the best childhood. Opportunities and confidence wise, I had a mix of like both good and bad teachers. I didn't have the best accommodating environment. I was always feeling that I'm just not on par with my friends, and I still remember the time when I think it was on my fifth or sixth grade, we used to like have these speech competitions back in school. And like the one of the teachers told me that I shouldn't participate in the speech competition because I took too long to speak. So yeah, so it was not the most accommodating environment back at home. In 2014, I moved to the US to start my bachelor's degree. And when I first came into the US, my I just discovered so many new resources that I didn't know existed. So I've like found the accommodation of office and a very encouraging advisor and just so many new things for me. My major starting in college was economics, but in my first year of my college, I like attended a coding class for just fun, and I just like loved the class so much that I like changed my major to computer science in my sophomore year. I think for me, programming, it came a way to who express myself. I like still remember for one of the class projects, I made a bot of which made the computer speak on behalf of me. So it just gave me so many new ways to express myself and soared my confidence to a new level. So the one of the turning point in my school was I got the Google Lime scholarship. It's a scholarship for students with disabilities who are computer science majors. I'm just going to Google just seeing so many more disabled students who were studying computer science too. It was just fantastic. So I started to gain more and more confidence in my computer science skills. It like automatically gave me the courage and the strength to speak up and to share my story. So if you had asked me to do this talk, say 4 years back, like I would not say yes at all. Like I was so scared to even speak a sentence to people. Then after 4 years of gaining so much confidence in my skills, it gave me the courage to share my story. In my junior year of college, I attended a assistive technology conference called CSUN. And my passion for accessibility started from there. When I came back from the conference, and I worked with my advisor to make a workshop and to teach coding to blind individuals. So a lot of the coding tools are there now. They are not the best accessibility wise for say blind users. They are not screen reader accessible. They have low contrast issues and a lot of problems. So we worked to make an accessible camp of them. In the past 2 years, as a research assistant, I've been working the same thing. And another one of my life milestone was that back in summer, interviewed for a internship at Microsoft, and I got it, and be starting my full-time job there the next June. The year is wrong there. It should be 2021, not 2020. So the one of the things what helped me in my Microsoft interview was to ask for accommodations. So speaking, for me, it's a very tiring job to do. So I can speak for Emacs of like, say, 40 to 50 minutes of without feeling too tired. So what I did was like ask them for accommodations where I could type instead of speak. So the interviewer could have a Google Doc at this front, and we both would type in the same doc, so they could see my responses at the same time. And that was the perfect solution for me. And I still remember, like, at my one of my first campus interviews back in my sophomore year, I like tried to hide my speech impairment so much that the interviewers felt that I could not speak English. So as I like started to learn more about the accommodations process and their disability disclosure process, it just made my interview so much more better than before. And then I started to do well on my school and my career. I like started to share my story. Think like it was such a big change for me, because as I said before, it was just so ashamed of my speech impairment that I like I would just not talk to people. But when I like started to gain skills in computer science and in my research, my confidence changed so much. So I just like want to share some of the things of like what is it to like to be a student with disability and CS. I think the good things is that one of my favorite is that my disability like drives innovation. So whenever like trying to code or trying to make a product, I can think of it from the whole perspective that like, how do we make the product more accessible to everybody? And the major things of what could be better is the process for accommodations for sure. I think if I knew what accommodations meant in my sophomore or my junior year or year, I would have spent all that time preparing better. But it's not late. I did understand them slowly. And then at this stage, I'm not shy to ask for what I need to do well. And another thing is attitudinal barriers. Like it's, just had so many times that people, they are just surprised to see that I'm a computer science student, and somehow think that my speech and my stutter it is related to lower intelligence, and it just makes me sad every time. And I just have a last slide on like key takeaways of like what y'all can do to support your disabled students. So I think the first thing what to me so much is to find a community of support. Access Computing is the largest organization for students with disabilities who who are studying computer science, and they have supported me so very much. They funded me for my first research internship. They funded me for my first conference, and like it was just so beneficial to me. I think the second tip I have is to seek out ways to teach accessible coding. So as I said before, not all the coding environments are the best in terms of accessibility. If you check out the Fordham language, they have so many wonderful tools for beginner computer science students to learn how to code, and they work well with the screen readers for blind students, and it's really good. The third takeaway that I had was to explain them the accommodation process. Like, it can really change the way you interview your jobs. It made my life so much more easier. And the fourth takeaway was to make sure the teaching materials are accessible. So for example, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, so much has now shifted virtual. So if you upload a video of your course, make sure to add the captions to it. And adding captions is not that hard. We have a lot of sites where you just upload the video and they automatically generate the captions for you. So it is like, it is people think that it's a big task to caption videos, but it's not really. Then don't to take too much time from Aether, but just the last two points were that if you go to Google Scholar and just like type computer science education, there you can find so many researchers are doing so much new work for students with disabilities. And the last point was to not use the words such as special needs or differently abled. They are slowly being not sure of the right word to use. A lot of the disability community, they don't like that word. And I have the link for more information as to why that is. So yeah, thank you so much of your patience by listening to me. And I will stop sharing now for Aether to start.
Thank you, Mina. Should I share my screen then? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay,
great. One second. I'm still learning how to use computers. So just a couple of seconds.
Funny.
Can you all see my screen? Yes, okay, I just need 1 second. I'll just set up dual monitors there. And then, great. Okay, I'm gonna go into the present mode. Okay, can you all still see my screen? Yes, okay, great. Yep. Thank you. So I'm obviously really glad to be here. I'm delighted to be here talking to you all. We had a similar session a few months ago, and we really enjoyed it, and we're just glad to be back here again talking to you all. So I'm just going to focus more on having a conversation with you. So I'm just going to go through the slides very, very quickly. I really want to have give all of your time to kind of have a good conversation. So I'm going to focus on that a little bit. So that's me. I'm as Maureen said, I'm a PhD student at the University of Washington, my third year. I have about 50 more years to go, but we'll see how that ends up being. So, you know, that, and I'm a software engineer at Comcast, and I'm the founder and researcher at Evox Labs. It's an organization, it's a grassroots initiative focused on bridging the gap between technology and people with disabilities. We'll talk about it a little bit. But this is my cat, as Maureen or anybody else who has been a part of this talk before has already met her. She is old now. She's 11 years old, white, Maine Coon, very grumpy. Do you all have cats? Yes? Okay, well, I really am sorry, because now you've seen the most beautiful cat in the world and you will never see your cat the same again. So I apologize. But yeah, that's Zoe. I owe it to her to put her on my slides every single time. This is me a long time ago. Much like Mina, I grew up in the in that region of the world as well. I grew up in Pakistan, and then I graduated with the bachelor's in software engineering from back home, from back there. And then I moved to, I lived in Karachi, which is a big metropolitan city, and I moved all the way to Grand Forks, North Dakota. So for all of you who do not know, North Dakota is not a myth, it's an actual state. It is actually on the map. If you've been there, I'm sorry, but if you've not been there, then you're not missing anything. It's all fine. So I went to school at University of North Dakota, that's in Grand Forks, that's about like 2 hours away from Canada, pretty cold. That's how it looks like pretty much, the snow, and they kind of like, you know, make our pathways through. So that's how North Dakota kind of looks like. Philadelphia, well, so North Dakota, I went to school in North Dakota. I didn't finish school in North Dakota because I had a car accident through which I severed my spine lost all the motory and sensory control of everything below the neck area. So we use the term of quadriplegic, or if that signifies that quad means four, plegic means limb. So when you lose the control of all four of your limbs, you call that person a quadriplegic. So when I got into a car accident, I had a spinal cord injury. So I was sent to rehab. North Dakota didn't have a rehab, which is expected. It's not a state that's very well established. So I was sent to Philadelphia for rehab. And so I came to Philadelphia. So go Eagles. I hope you all support Eagles. If you don't, that's fine too, but Eagles forever. So anyway, so I came to Philadelphia. These are some of my pictures when I came to the rehab. I couldn't really, I was in rehab for about a year for inpatient and outpatient, kind of recovering from that. So that's the, unlike Mina, I was introduced to disability at a very late stage of my life. I was in my 20s when I kind of learned or was introduced to the world of disabilities and being a person with a disability. It was a very new concept for me. So growing up, I didn't have much of an understanding of what disability means, what it looks like, what are the challenges, what are the restrictions, and what is the world out there for people with disabilities. I didn't really know. I was a software engineer, but I didn't really realize it at that point in time. What I did realize, though, is after I got injured, I realized how difficult it was, right? I lost control of my hands. I was a software engineer. It's very typical for a software engineer to type code. And I couldn't do that. So I really questioned that if this is something that I could do. I really questioned that if this is a life that I want to be a part of. Because there was only one thing that I was good at, and that was writing code, programming. And I went to grad school for that. And I just felt like that was taken away from me, and I couldn't do much. So I questioned that if this is like, if there is a life of like, there's a purpose in my life at that point in time. But then obviously, as you tend to accept your disability identity, then at that point, I realized that there are ways that you can contribute to the world and you find the purpose in life. You know, there are ways that you can kind of see that, I'm a software engineer, but this is what I am now, and this is what my life is. And now I've seen disability as a first-hand experience. So what can I do to make the world better? What can I do to make other people who are in the same boat as me not face the same problems or make the world a little bit better for them? How can I contribute? So for that, I started this organization. It's called as Evox Labs. You all can go take a look at Evox Labs. It's a volunteer organization. So we organize hackathons, we organize conferences, and then we also had internship opportunities for students to take a part. Students with disabilities to take a part and kind of just like get the exposure out in the real CS world. So we did all of that in collaboration with Access Computing, a resource that Mina shared. So I recommend you all to kind of take a look at it. So that organization was started in Philadelphia in 2015. It still works. It's still working fine. Just collaborate with a lot of people, a lot of organizations in that sense. Then I started working for Comcast. A lot of people they asked me two questions. If why is their internet broken? I don't know why your internet is broken. I don't work in that capacity. But also, I don't work in the capacity in the area of accessibility at Comcast. I'm focused on software engineering side of it. So I've been with Comcast since. Contrary to popular belief, it's an okay organization to work for, you know. But then I moved to Chicago, then I moved to Seattle. Now I live in Seattle. It's sunny outside, which is like Northern Lights, so that's great. But I've been living in Seattle since 2018. I moved here for school to start my PhD program at University of Washington, which is a top five in the country in CS. And I'm really, really glad that Mina is coming to Seattle as well. So I'm just excited to see Mina very soon in June. I started at Seattle. You all from Texas, so you're probably familiar with what it looks like when it snows and nobody's prepared for it. So Seattle is a very opportunistic city. So when it did snow, and because it's hilly, people just started snowing on the street, snowboarding on the street and just skiing on the street. So that's an actual picture that happened like 3 years ago when we got our first snow. This is just a husky that I kind of found at a beer garden and decided to take a picture, but that's just to signify that I was at University of Washington. So my current commitments are that I do accessibility research. My focus in research is in the area of human-computer interaction. I build systems and tools that adapt to the users versus the users adapting to the systems. I build systems that see abilities as a spectrum and not as a dichotomy between people with disabilities and people without disabilities. So that's what I focus on. I'm a software engineer at Comcast, founder of research at Evox Labs. I serve as an executive board of directors at the Alliance of People with Disabilities here in Seattle and Washington. I am also an FLP fellow, which is the Future Leadership in the Professorate. I consider myself as a huge disability rights advocate. I do a lot of open source civic hacking projects that are kind of related to Evox Labs, what we do there as well. And I'm really, really proficient in eating donuts. So that's just something that I tell people, and that's something that you all should know about me. So what is it like to be a student with a disability in CS? So I'm just going to share some of my experiences there. And I know Mina has shared some of hers. So first is I want to focus on the difficult part of it. The difficult part of it is just as somebody with a mobility disability, somebody who's in a wheelchair, campus accessibility is really, really important, right? So wherever you all are, whichever school you're in, it's important to kind of like start thinking about like, okay, well, how accessible are the classrooms? How accessible is the campus, right? Are people able to enter a classroom without having to be really hard to even push the door open? Are there push buttons there? Is there a ramp there? What about stairs? Are there stairs that block in their ways and things like that? So that's an important thing to consider. Then the note taking and typing, it's a very difficult task for somebody who has limited hand function. So it's important to think about those things as well. And most of those things are provided as an accommodation through the disability resources in your respective organization. But that's something as a counselor, as a teacher, to kind of keep an eye out for. What can we do to kind of identify the need for someone to do note taking and typing, and what can we do about them, and how can we redirect them to appropriate resources? So I think that's really important. Now the third part that is really difficult and that might not be evident is for somebody with a disability to have a constant feeling of proving themselves to others. And I think we kind of sense that in Mina's talk as well. And most people with disabilities go through that. They just feel like they have a need to constantly prove themselves to others. And that's a very unhealthy thing. And most of the times, even they don't know that they have to do that. They just are put into a society and in a situation where they just have to. So it's important as counselors and as teachers to recognize when those things are happening and give them the proper guidance, being there for them. It's really, really important, right? Because they might be struggling with things that you might not know, and they might not be something that they might not even know. So that's something to keep an eye out for and things that to consider. Accommodation processes, even though there are organizations such as like Office of Disabilities, disability offices, and whatever the name is at your respective organizations, they are a pain. It takes forever to get an accommodation set up. Even then, you have to provide documentation. You have to do all of those things. So it's important as counselors and teachers to kind of start thinking about those things. And so usually in universities, what professors would tend to do is that they would tend to say that, okay, well, if you have a disability, go to the accommodation office and I don't have to deal with it. And that's kind of like what the process is. But that process itself is a little bit painful. So while the right way is for them to go to the accommodation processes, so the accommodation people at the accommodation offices can actually understand what the real needs are and then help them appropriately, it still doesn't take away from the fact that we as teachers and educators will just redirect them there and not do anything about it. For any short-term adjustments that we can make, even if that's something to keep your door open, letting them know that, you know, you're there for them, is itself something that is important. Excuse me. So the next part that I have there is that it's a little bit annoying as well. As a student with a disability, you automatically become a diversity candidate. You automatically become that token. Everybody wants to take pictures with you and publish you in school magazines. I never had the face for it, but I always found myself on the cover, and you know, so it was just like a little bit annoying that why just me? Why can't it be anybody else? You become lab rats, and that's usually not the case in like in K-12 education, but generally. Generally what you would see is somebody's doing research, they will always reach out to you because you fit the criteria of something that they're working on. And if you're the only couple of people in the entire school who have some sort of a disability, then it's just kind of like a little bit of having a feeling of being a lab rat. So it's not the greatest. It's a little bit annoying. I mean, I'm happy to help out with any kind of research projects, but then again, it's a little bit annoying that way. It also happens for people who are blind, who use screen readers. for others to reach out to them and tell them that, hey, I'm kind of making something accessible. Could you proofread this for me? I don't really have to. Similarly, it's like, well, hey, we're building a ramp. Can you test it out for us? Yes, but also no. But so it's like a little bit annoying that way. So just make sure that as educators and as counselors, we don't put students with disabilities in a position that they need to do something just because they have a disability. It's very exhausting to educate people. It's very exhausting to fix problems or be the proofreaders for things. So it's great for people to kind of just go out there, read and educate themselves first before coming to a student with a disability or a person with a disability and asking them, hey, what do I do? So kind of like that. What is satisfying to be in CS, and I think some people some people just get demotivated, and when they do, I think these are the things that we should remind them of, is that being in CS, much like in other fields as well, it's there's a lot of innovation going on, right? You're making a difference in the world, you're changing the world, you're shaping the future, all of those things. And I think people with disabilities need to be told, or not to be told, but like they need to be motivated that they can still be a part of CS because they can get all of these satisfying factors. They can innovate, they can change the world, just like anybody else, just so they don't feel that they can't do those things. So it's important to kind of show them the satisfying side of it, where sometimes it's very hard to see. There's a paper that we worked on, it might be helpful. It's called Navigating Graduate School with a Disability. Most of the concept applies to undergrad school and K-12 education as well. So we wrote this paper, published it last year, so it might be helpful for as a resource for you all to read. I'm not trying to advertise. I'm just sharing a resource that we published a little while ago. But final takeaways is, and I'll try to wrap this up really quickly. As Mina said, educate yourself and be cognizant of the politically correct terms. There are terms that are accepted in society. There are terms that are not. And the only way to find that out is to actually connect with the disability community and know what they prefer. Without that, it's really hard to know which terms are okay, which terms are not. For example, and some of the terms are not that easy. It's difficult because there's varying preferences. For example, I prefer a person-first language, so saying people with disabilities. Some people prefer identity-first language, which is very, very huge in the autism culture, that they don't like it when you call them people with autism. They don't like that. They prefer an identity-first language, so they call themselves autistic people. So people with disabilities versus disabled people, that there are different things. One is person first, was an identity first. Some people prefer one, some or the other. There's a huge debate about that. I prefer that, so it's varying. So it's difficult. The point is to say that it's difficult sometimes, but it's only helpful if you're cognizant of those things. One of the most important things is provide a safe space. You know, there are people who have
hello?
There are people who have visible disabilities, and then there are people who don't. For as counselors and educators, if you provide a safe space, people who don't have visible disabilities will be able to come and talk to you. And that's the goal, for them to be able to come and share those things and talk about those things and look out for help or anything that they need from you whenever they need it. So if you provide them a safe space, then they would be able to do that. So that's important. Increase representation of people with disabilities. I think it's really important that for students that are in your school to meet other people with disabilities. It's important to find their role models that look the same, that talk the same, that are the same, are similar to them. It's really important. So bring in people with disabilities. Make that don't make that a one-off thing. Make that as a recurring thing. Have constant panels. Make sure that you connect those students with the mentors out in the community so they can see what they can be when they get out of school. It's really, really, really important. And to do all of those things, just take some initiatives, get the training if that's needed. Mina shared a bunch of good resources. They're great resources. And finally, I would just leave you with this, that there are two things. One is that if there's one thing that we have learned from the Black Lives Matter movement, that is that we don't need a movement for someone to realize that people have rights. People with disabilities do not need a movement for everyone to know that they have rights. That's something that, if there's one thing that you can learn from that, that's, I think that's really important. So let's not wait for people with disabilities to go out on the street and tell everyone that they have rights too. I think we can all educate ourselves, understand that before it gets to that point. I think it's really, really important. And I will leave you with one last thing, and that is, nothing about us is without us. If you're going to do something for people with disabilities, involve them, bring them in, not just because they are people with disabilities, but also because it's their world, it's our world. If you're going to do something in our world, you should involve us. Get our feedback and improve that inclusion for us. So it's, I think, important to be allies, but the motto goes the same. It's nothing about us and without us. So with that, I will stop sharing. I need to do that. Okay. I will stop sharing here, and then I really want to, I'm here to answer any questions. I know Mina is here as well. So I'll leave that for you all.
Wow. Oh, wonderful. Thank you, Mina and Aether. And so let's open it up for any questions or reflections or anything you want to ask or just speak about. Go ahead and unmute if you'd like to add to the chat. We can read the questions in the chat as well. But I want you both to know that nothing about us without us. Oh, I love that so much. When you shared that last year, it was, I think, in November or October, November. So I brought it back to the NCWIT staff meeting with all the big wigs, you know. And I said, guess what? This quote is from Aether and Mina's their presentation, and it really resonated with so many people on so many levels. So I thank you for that. So what questions do people have, or for either Mina or Aether? Feel free to unmute.
Well, my question was actually further back during Mina's presentation, and it was, what do you think a school counselor would have been able to help you with better?
Sure. So back in India, I don't think that we had school counselors per se, so we just had teachers. I think from a perspective of like what teachers would do better is that, and I'm not saying that all the teachers like are the same, just I think a few of them, like as I shared an example of the speech competition and stuff, I was intentionally being excluded from those, and that was really affecting my confidence. I think if a teacher, they just like came up to me and just said that, if you want, you can speak for 5 minutes. Can we do something to help you to like be more calm, or to just help your stress levels to be to be able to speak to a large audience. Think that would have like helped me so much.
Yeah. So being more of an advocate, being able to get in there for the kiddo and saying, hey, why can't she participate? You know, what's up with that? How can we help? Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
That is something where I think you would find most school counselors would be in there going, what can we do? We're going to make this happen. So thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it's just it just takes 2 seconds to ask what you need, and it makes you feel so valued, you know? Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
So there's some few comments and just comments and reflections in the chat. And I, you know, as counselors, we always ask, you know, I'm just interested, what do you do for self-care? How do you deal? How do you decompress? Like, what do you do? Like, first of all, how do you have time to do all these amazing things that you're doing? But what do you do to take care of yourself? Like, what are your modes of self-care? We talk about that a lot in counseling. I would really be interested in hearing that.
I can share a small, interesting thing. Also, people who have a stutter like me, they don't tend to stutter while they sing. So if I started to sing now, like, I would be the most fluent person in the whole world. So of the past, I think it's been 9 months or so, I've started to take voice lessons to sing, and I just helps me so much just to calm down and to, like, it sounds a bit weird to, like, feel fluency, and, like, yeah, it just singing is very calming for me.
The music teacher in me is so happy.
I just call it the choral effect. Mm-hmm. I think it's when and you sing, or like if people are like speaking to you at the same time, you don't stutter. So
I love singing.
Well, I don't have the voice to sing, so that's that. But
everyone can sing.
Thank you, Ruth. I am a graduate student at the end of the day, so I don't have much life. So that's that. But I tend to go on walks a lot, and I tend to watch a lot of TV shows. It's a little bit unhealthy, the amount of TV shows that I watch. But I tend to follow a lot of TV shows, and I critique them a lot. For myself, I find them very relaxing to kind of just change and think about something entirely different.
So my question to you is the same then. What would a school counselor been able to better do for you? Ather?
I can go first. I think that's really important. Some of the things that I mentioned is, for when it comes down to people with disabilities, Let's try to see all of that from a holistic point of view. The holistic point of view is inclusion. The holistic point of view is for people with disabilities to really just feel that they can, they don't have to struggle, and that the world is, the society is just not very friendly for people with disabilities. It's difficult. I mean, we have to, every person with a disability has their own struggles, and every day in some ways for doing our daily life activities, we are reminded of that fact. And so the only thing that we kind of don't want is that when we go in settings such as in education, at work, in recreation, we don't feel the same there, because that's our outlet. That's where we don't want to look for those things. In our daily life, we are reminded of that every single second. When we wake up to the point we go to bed, there are things that happen during the day of smaller things, even when we lift up a cup or put it down or talk to someone. When it comes down to counselors, and if I'm in school, then I'm just really looking for someone who understands me. I'm just really looking for someone who can really, I can just be myself with. I can go and tell them how I feel without being judged, without being, for it to be just a safe space. And I think for to achieve that, it's really important that all the counselors and educators and teachers are aware of what a disability means. That they have educated themselves to an extent where I can feel comfortable going to them and talking about my disability. So I don't have to tell them the struggles that I face.
That's I was glad to hear you use the word spectrum. My youngest is on the autistic, is on the spectrum. And I really like it when people refer to it as it's a spectrum, because there are days where it's better for him than others. And so to me, that's part of the spectrum as well. It's kind of like us, we're all on a spectrum, because if I didn't have coffee, it would not be a good thing. So I think in a lot of ways, we're all on a spectrum. So and I know one of the things that frustrates me for him is when people hear, oh, he's autistic, so it's this, or he's autistic, so it, you know, here's his little box. And to remind us, we all have a box, if you want to look at it that way, but none of us wants to be a box. We all want to be, you know, a spectrum of a person. We have likes, we have dislikes, we have things we can do and things we can't do.
Absolutely, Ruth. And I'll just add to that, that when people look at disabilities, they usually look at permanent disabilities. They usually think of somebody in a wheelchair, or somebody who has mental health issues, or someone who is deaf or blind. But the truth is that people have different varying level of abilities. And sometimes that's situational. Sometimes that's temporary. For example, in temporary disability, you can imagine someone who's just broken their leg, they will be fine. But while during that time, they might be doing the exact same thing that a person with a permanent disability does. Then there are these things called situational disabilities. And that you can imagine, for example, a woman who's pregnant. You wouldn't expect a pregnant woman to climb up the stairs. So why do we not have elevators? Things like that. It gets to a point where you can think about people who live in cold weather, right? And they have to wear gloves all the time. So how are they going to use their phones? They can't. So this is where we start thinking about, okay, well, there's this also this thing called as text to speech. This is how that technology, you know, you start seeing that technology for all the different purposes. So there are sometimes, so for example, you can also imagine like the technology that now we have where we can kind of just speak to our phone without touching it. Like, hey Siri, for example, we didn't have that before. We couldn't just say, hey Siri, and Siri would just start listening. That didn't happen before. But that's also a situational disability in the sense that your hands might be, you might be cooking, your hands might be tied in something, and you can't really, you know, do something, but you need your phone. So it's a really broad topic, and the way to look at it is sometimes people get into this the little box of thinking that disability is just, you know, not just that person in a wheelchair, that person with a cane, or that person who's deaf, but it's a little bit more than that, you know. It's just applies to everyone, so definitely a spectrum.
Wow, sadly our time has come to an end, and it's always, as again, it's been fantastic to see you both, Mina and Aether. Thank you so much for presenting with us today, and there was just so much again that just resonated with me. I think, Mina, when you mentioned that you were using a Google Doc and it was a chance to communicate live with your teammates, I'm like, you were a visionary, right? We're all doing that now. And there's just so much. And I think most of all, we need to educate ourselves first. And I love that message. And I think it's something that we have to continue to share with not just, you know, other counselors and educators, but just the public in general. Just educate ourselves on how we can be, you know, all of us can be advocates. Oh, well, I just, again, thank you so much for joining us for this presentation. Good luck with your move, Mina. I'm not sure when that's going to happen. Hopefully it won't be in the snow, or hopefully it'll be in the summer when you can just like enjoy Seattle, right? And Aether, I need some recommendations on some new shows to watch. So. But don't recommend anything that I'll become too addicted to, because I have too much work to do as well. But anything else, Kelsey, anything else to add before we end for today?
No, thank you both so much.
Thanks for having us. Really appreciate it.
Yeah. All right. I think we covered all the time zones today. So have a great lunch or dinner or breakfast or wherever you are. Okay, take care, both of you. We'll be in touch again, I'm sure.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Bye-bye.